Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows your name, and they're always glad you came. You wanna be where you can see our troubles are all the same. You wanna be where everybody knows your name.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome back to the show, back to the week, although we did do one yesterday. So, no, getting all confused already, and it's the top of the show. Thank you, everybody, for joining us here tonight. We don't have my co-host with the mo-host, Mr. Joe Fulton, with us tonight. He has family issues. So, instead, I'm going to try out a new co-host, a new Joe, a replacement Joe, perhaps. We will be joined by Mr. Joe Sontag, not Catapano, as Joe thought. Did I say Catapano yesterday? I can't remember. But we got Joe Sontag here from, obviously, the book Reaper Destroyer. You all know him from the show, the hit CG show, Art and Stuff. And I'll get him in just a moment. But before I do, let me say hello to you wonderful people here in the chat tonight. We've got B-Rose calling first. NTM hits back with a kick, B Rose. You guys decide where you want to take that from there. We've got Micro in the house. There he is right there. He says, see you all soon. He will. I give him about 3 minutes. I'll bring him on. He's sitting there waiting very patiently. I see you there, Joe. I see you there. He gives me a thumbs up. Excellent. We've got Chauncey Blakey in the house. We've got Felix. That's how you're going. Aaron says, coom before the campaign. I always recommend you coom before you run your campaign. You don't want to go in there with your mind on anything else other than, making the campaign the best you can possibly make it. You don't want to be distracted. That's my advice to you. Hell, the Devil Flyer in the house. Who else we got? We got Shadow Hawk. We have Mr. Mo Biggs. Hal Mo Biggs. Hello, Ray Rahu's in the house. Ray is an incredible artist. I wasn't aware. I put his art as the banner on my Twitter, but I've really been starting to pay more attention. He just did a Inglourious Rex piece, which is really outstanding. So everyone make sure you go follow Ray over there on Twitter. He's doing great stuff. And Insanity X Draws as well. Who else do we have in here? Who else do I spy? So I see Frog G shilling the channel. Joe's got two channels. He's one that I wasn't aware of. He's actually bigger than the Art and Stuff channel. I'm going to chat to him about that, see what he's up to over there. Who else do I see in here? Did I say Crazy Mad? I just had Crazy Mad up. I'm an idiot. Don't bother me. I hope everyone had fun yesterday with the horses. I wanted to make sure I did it, even though it was kind of my day off. I wanted to make sure I did it, so we set a precedent. It's sort of like a yearly thing that everyone can look forward to, although it was pretty crazy. Hello, Colin. Hello, Jeremy Burtz, Creators Outlet. Hello, Sheev McQueen. I see you all coming in here now. Fear Lantern's here. I just left the Russian pimp stream for this one. Thank you, Fear Lantern. What's the Russian pimp stream? I'm not aware of that one. I was just over hanging out with Eric Weathers and the fellas over on the CG team. We can continue that conversation here, actually, because it probably pertains to what Joe wants to talk about tonight. Is Joe in the chat because you forgot to send in the link? Is Joe really in the chat? No, he has family issues. He said he can't make the show tonight. He's got family things on. Who else do I see here? Who else? I presume you're talking about Falter, albino Thunderbirds. You got Mike TV in the house, Mr. Von Stugel. Alois Dorlos here. Great to see. All right, still not even 5 minutes yet. This is so nice and easy breezy tonight. Thank you, everyone. The Reddit members in here. We've got Gusto, Fallout Zone G. Howdy, says Mr. Red Gaze. and other Joe Bancroft. Oh, right. That's, yeah, because I'm gatekeeping him. Well, you know, if he's going to be my new co-host, if he's going to be my new Joe, he's going to have to learn for me to ignore him a little bit. Antoine Dennison is in the house. No Joe, no justice. Well, you asked for him. I don't want to deny justice to Joe. So let me bring him in right now. Welcome to the show, Joe.
What's going on, man? Thank you for having me. What's going on, chat? Hail, chat.
It feels odd. You know, I've got I swapped out my Joes tonight.
I know, right? I'm wondering, like, how does it feel to be the replacement Joe? That's the thing. That's the thing.
Well, the thing is, though, if you're going to replace Joe Fulton, you've got to really up your costume game to extreme levels.
Yeah, I don't think I could touch him on that. Yep.
No, who can?
Yeah, I was going to say you can,
but then I changed to who can. I don't think anyone can.
Yeah, that's high aspirations there, I think.
Antoine's calling out your camera settings. You're like on a 360p or something. Let me make you full screen so you can see. Look at this. Really? You look very blurry to me. You probably look fine on your end. It's probably your internet.
Yeah, let me see. Oh yeah, you're right. I just checked out.
Fear Lantern says, yeah, you got to go full Elton John. I'm talking glasses. I'm talking hats, t-shirts, paraphernalia, flags. You've got to go the whole way. Hello, Don Chin. And hello, Vilned.
Hail, Don.
And Robert Shepherd is here too. I miss Robert Shepherd. There he is. Joe, what's been going on? That's slightly better.
Is it better?
Look, it's good enough for me.
I was just checking it out on the actual YouTube stream. You're right. It's really blurry for some reason. That's odd. Usually Joe swapping. Good.
Yeah, that's what we're doing tonight. The SJW has even reached bankrupt. Yeah, we're Joe swapping tonight. You know, out with the old, in with the new. That's what it's all about. Elton Joe. Oh, we should call him that. That's very true. What's been going on in your world of late, Mr. Sontag?
Oh man, not too much. It's been really busy working on this ash can that, if you follow Art and Stuff, you follow my channel, you know I've been doing. So that's going really well. I've got 95 copies of that reserved, which is really awesome and humbling, that the support that I've gotten so far. I've been making some rounds lately, hitting some of the channels. Had a really awesome show with the Barton Brothers last week, I think. Really good conversations there. Busy, man. Besides my everyday life, family stuff, you know, when it comes to like the comic, I'm really trying to hunker down and get on to promotion and really get this ash can out.
Yeah, I was on the stream where you launched this ash can, if we want to call it that. You really launched the way you did it. I don't know if it is considered a launch, but
the closest to
I must can, yeah. I must admit I was slightly confused as to what was going on, but I enjoyed it nonetheless. We got a Dagger Outlaw in the house. Great to see you here. We got Rick Saylor in the house. How, Rick Saylor?
Rick.
You did what Sean did, which is to put out a book, sort of you just put out a book through social media, right? I guess. Anyone who wants to grab a copy, I presume you're still selling them.
Yep, so, it's still for sale until November 19th. So what it was is, this was actually something that Sean came up with. And it goes back to his convention days. You know, he was an artist going to conventions, selling his work, selling sketchbooks. And what he would do with anybody that couldn't buy on the day that they were there, could always follow him on social media and they could always message him and he could directly sell them a copy of his work, you know, right to him through PayPal or whatever. So he had this idea of doing it and it worked out real well. I think he sold like 80 copies of his ash can, and it was just like the old school way of get a hold of me, PayPal information, and you know,
it's like a really cool business card.
And the biggest thing, there was a few things. There was one, we were both big fans of ash cans, like back in the 90s, going to cons, getting the ash can of the book before, you know, well in advance before it came out. You know, it was a nice behind the scenes, kind of black and white, smaller version of the book. And it's just, as far as collectors go, it was something that we always really enjoyed. The second part was, it's kind of a backwards way of doing a little bit of a copyright when you're sending something
I've
through
heard,
the mail.
I've heard Kenneth Rocafort mention this because he controversially released only 500 ash cans of Roken before launching the main thing. And yeah, that caused all the stir because, I mean, he's Kenneth friggin' Rocafort.
Yeah.
He's, you know, he's got these highly sought after, thing. Sorry, excuse me. I'm just setting up some props here. Highly sought after property, obviously, and you know, everything he does is a big name sort of thing. So that was actually the first that I'd heard about this thing of putting out the ashcan first. Now, is your book an ashcan like this, which is a full size thing, but it's only 12 pages, or is it an ashcan like this?
Yeah, it's more like the CyberFrog ash can.
Like
yeah.
this. So it's a proper... Yeah. What is this size, by the way?
How is that? Like 6.5? It's a little bit It's a little bit smaller than actual book.
Will it be a preview of the main... The book that will eventually be crowdfunded?
Yeah, for the most part, it's... So the ash can is going to be the first 6 pages, fully inked and fully scripted, with a... We're going to do... Or I say... I'm going to do character sketches, character bios. There's going to be an in-depth look at the history and the backstory of the Reaper Destroyer mythos. A little bit of a journey showing where I started this adventure, so to speak, when I tried to originally do this concept back in 2006 until now. So there's going to be, I'm going to put a lot of little extras in it, you know, to make it worthwhile. But the big thing I'm selling on is this is going to be a true collectible. You know, it's never going to be printed again. It's only going to have this cover on it. So the actual book is going to, I'm going to draw a brand new cover for the actual book. So it's be the only time you can find this cover in print. And instead of me going
So this is the only, this cover right here that we're seeing that has been causing this massive stir. It's got this sort of, really cool modern Silvestri vibe to it here. This is it on That's the ash it. Can.
Yep.
Wow.
That, and I made that decision because I went on to like Twitter a couple times. I had a poll one because I wanted to see if people wanted the like the traditional ash can size or if they wanted like the bigger size. And the traditional size won out on the poll, so that's what I ended up going with. And I talked to a few people and they were like, if you're gonna do the ash can and you're not gonna have a special cover for the ash can, which I didn't have one, then they're saying like make that an exclusive cover and then do a brand new one for the campaign. I was like, I can do that. I was like, that completely works. So I made a decision to have this one just be the ash can cover. So this would be the only time in print you'll be able to get this cover would be on the ash can. So actual campaign in April, brand new cover.
We've got a few covers from the chat, questions from the chat here. Fear Lantern says, when you did it that way, did you print a surplus to sell? I'm guessing that's talking about the ash cans at conventions and stuff.
Oh, so well, the old school way of doing it is, yeah, Sean would. So this, again, this all came from my partner in Ott and Stuff, Sean Aaron, his idea. So when he would go to cons, he would have his sketchbooks and whatever else he would be selling at his table. And he would have, a surplus of supply. And then he just sell extras as it goes. Mm-hmm. When it comes to this is a semi version of a crowdfunding, but through more of a direct to the customer way of doing something where you are, shipping's included in this. It's just $20. So shipping's included in it. I'm gonna try to get this shipped out by Christmas. So pretty much everything I need for the ash cam is pretty much done. I just need to put it together, do the graphic designs, all that kind of stuff, and make sure that the files are right.
And you'll only be printing as many as you need.
Yeah, I might overprint just a little, but it just depends. Yeah. Like this is
sort of included. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. This is
to cover any.
Right. So this isn't a big for anybody wondering out there, this isn't a big money making scheme. You know, it's a small print run. And so it's basically one that I want to do it to generate a little bit of excitement. Cause if I get it out there in the ether, you know, of everybody and start seeing it, people getting it, maybe reviewing it or popping it up, that could spark some interest. I want to also drop the mailing list sometime, I think maybe in December. So to kind of coincide with this being shipped out to people. And three, we wanted to show that we could deliver on something. You know, like if you can trust us as creators, both Sean and I, that we can deliver. Now, Sean's already done it. He did this, got his book out. Everybody got it, was very pleased with it. So, you know, pretty much now it's my turn to do that as well. And yeah, basically just get a hold of me in my DMs, whether any social media, whether it's Twitter, Facebook, you know, Instagram.
I put Joe's Twitter handle as the top link in the description there for anyone who wants to grab this thing. Mo Big says, this cover looks excellent, but there's a major error with the trade dress. Where is the chocolate starfish logo?
Well,
you made a mistake there. I mean, clearly missed opportunity. You've got a star in there, but
yeah, so I put the star in there as a wink and a nod to the chocolate starfish. But like I said,
you used the word wink with the chocolate starfish together.
I was just gonna say, like, I had a real issue of, you know, like putting a butthole on my cover.
I feel you.
I decided John not to says, go in that direction.
Everyone's agreeing. The cover looks awesome.
Thank you.
A hero perched over the city is always badass. Well, especially one that looks like this. I told you already, I love his ripped up cape. I think it's great storytelling. The colors are superb.
Oh, yeah.
On this. And we're going to get into your team in a little bit here, because there's some people who are asking questions about that.
Yeah,
Rick Saylor says, 100% recommend get Reaper Destroy Ashcan, hit you up on social media. Are you shipping this thing out internationally?
I've gotten a few requests internationally, and the biggest thing is the shipping aspect of it, because it's damn expensive to ship overseas. I've talked to a few people where I've tried to work out some deals that would be beneficial to both them and me, so it's not hurting me too much to ship stuff out, and it's not hurting them out, hurting them as well. So that's kind of something. If you're overseas, still DM me and we can talk to see what works best for both of us.
You know what?
I would like to try to get one to you as best.
I might get one and get it sent to Joe, and then you know, later on at some point in the future, when Joe might want to send me something like a bunch of different stuff, he can just slip it in there. That might be the best way for me to do it.
Yeah, it's I've got a guy that did that. He has a brother in the States and he's, you know, abroad. And basically that's what he did. He gave me his address. I'm going to ship his copy to his brother. And then his brother's going to do pretty much what you said. Whenever he sends stuff over.
I don't want to cost you any money on this. And I know how it's fluctuating like crazy, especially out to Australia at the moment. Jasper says, I hate Ashcan. Just upsize it.
Yeah, I know.
Here's the thing. About here, you're like, no. Here's the thing about people in when they talk about crowdfunding stretch goals, they say, oh, we're gonna get better paper, we're gonna get a, you know, better print quality, that sort of stuff. It's like, you kind of these days, you get what you get. You know, most people, when you print on a nice gloss or something, you're gonna get the paper that you need. It's not like, oh, they're going to give you the crap paper unless you really specifically ask. It doesn't work like that.
Right.
What actually, what I'm saying is, you can't pay extra. You can't say, hey, if I slip you another $500, can you give me the good paper? It doesn't work like that. What does affect cost in a really significant way, we're talking potentially double the price, is the actual physical size of the book, because it relates to how many they can fit on a sheet. And so for you to upsize this to a regular size comic would actually significantly increase your costs. So I do completely understand the Ashcan, the whole purpose of it. You know, it's supposed to be a small promotional giveaway thing that doesn't cost a hell of a lot of money to produce and get out there. So
yeah,
and it's kind of the tradition of it as well.
Yeah, and that's kind of what, and I've had a couple people that talked about the size of it, and a few people that didn't want to get it for the size. And I was like, that's fine. You know, like that's completely understandable. It's basically one, because I am a nostalgic freak, you know, when it comes to stuff like that. And I just really wanted to put out a traditional size Ashcan, you know, and that was one, and I was actually happy that the poll went in that direction. So, and I would have done whatever the poll, you know, when I put that poll up, I was like, whatever they say, whatever wins out is what we'll do, whether it's traditional size or if it's the standard comic book size, that's what I'll do. And, you know, it went out traditional. So I was happy about that. And I talked to enough people that enjoyed that. You know, it's for the collectors, you know, of ash cans, which I am, you know. So so I completely understand if it's not on the level that some people might want to back it because of that reason. That's fine. There's no problems there. But like I said, like,
can't make everybody happy all the time.
Exactly. Yep. Exactly.
That's the way it is.
That's the
thing. Speaking of, BGC doesn't use Twitter. How can he?
Oh yeah.
And get a copy off you.
That's
how about you've got Facebook.
Yep.
Email.
No. Yeah. No worries there. So yeah, you can do Facebook. You could do Instagram, or you could just go right to my email, which is just my name. It's joemsontag@gmail.com. And I've got, I think I've sold 5 through people that didn't use social media.
And there's no underscores or anything like that. It's just joemsontag.
Right. Yep.
@gmail.com. And there's 2 N's in Sontag.
Yes.
Yep. Just check to see how I spelled his name in the title. I hope I spelt it right. I mean, I have been getting it wrong. Crazy Mad says, don't forget to tell them who's inking. Well, we can just scroll right in right here. What is with you and people with their names starting with J-O-E? Are you collecting them?
You know,
should have asked Joel to change his name to Joe just to make the
funny story. All my life, everything I've done, whether it was in music or in comics, I have always been in a group of guys with similar names. So when I was doing music for a while, there was a version of my band where 3 guys in the band out of the 4 were all named Joe. So it's this weird thing. Like I attract the Joes and the Joels and all that kind of stuff. So it's kind of odd. But talent wise, I won't complain because I got some top notch people working with me.
Well, tell us a bit. We got Villanet in the chat here asking, whose art is this? Reminds me of those great Silvestri scratch lines. So whose art is this on the cover? Who's on the team here?
Yeah, so that's my pencils, and it's Joe. Well, on the cover inks is Jimmy Reyes. So mm-hmm. Short story, Jimmy Reyes was originally supposed to be the inker on the book, and that didn't work out, so we just kind of moved in a different direction, which is fine because that ended up landing me being able to work with the legendary inker Joe Weems, who was one of Mark Silvestri's inkers at Top Cow for years, as well as Matt Bat Banning from Top Cow. Both worked with Silvestri. I went after those guys because I would never put myself in the category of Mark Silvestri whatsoever, but there's influences there, and there's a stylistic aspect of my work that I like.
I'm sure it'll work out well for you.
Yeah, yeah. That I could say, you know, it's influenced. And I was thinking of inkers to work with, and I couldn't think of any better inkers to work with than the guys that I saw ink my favorite artists, one of my favorite artists for years as a kid. So I don't know if it was the pandemic or whatever, but it just kind of worked out that I reached out to these guys at kind of the right moment, I guess, for me. And showed them my art, you know, had conversations back and forth, and they agreed to do the book. And I'll tell you what, that's a dream come true, because to see my work finished by a professional inker, especially one that I've followed since I was a little kid, is crazy to me. You know, when I get pages back and I see this stuff, I'm just like, it blows me away. For one, that I'm just working with these guys, you know, like it really is a dream come true. Like I wanted to grow up when I was a kid and work for Image and work with all these talented guys. And now I got a chance to, and it's great. It's awesome.
All right. There's a bunch of people asking questions in the chat here, so I got to get to them. Hold on. Jasper says, are the ash cans signed and numbered like the Cyberforce and Pit ash cans?
So with the signature, if and when you get a hold of me in my DMs, I ask you specifically if you want it signed.
Or email.
Any way you get a hold of me, I ask you specifically if you want it signed. Because I know some people don't like it being signed. Mm-hmm. So I leave it as an option. And yeah. I've even had a couple people want a specific spot where it's signed. And that's fine. You know, like all those instructions work perfectly. And I'll do whatever you want. I'll work with you. I haven't thought about the numbering yet, perhaps, you know, but it's just the thing about the numbering. as far as like going out one through, you know, 95 or 100 or how many end up reserving, of like who gets that, you know, who gets the number one, who gets this,
yeah,
who,
I don't
who
gets think
that,
if,
you know, it's
yeah, well,
hard
no,
for
but
me.
Also on top of that, I don't think you really can. If you're asking people not to sign it, you would presume they don't want you to write the number on it either.
Right. Yeah.
So unless it's printed on it, which you can do.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
Which would be probably an extra cost.
I was going to say, which would be an extra cost, but
unless it's printed on it, yeah, you're not going to be writing on it, because there's going to be some people who don't want you writing on it, which is their prerogative.
Yeah. So probably as of right now, probably not numbered, because I have not got a lot of requests for it or people really even talked about it. But the signature is the big thing. And for the most part, everybody wants to sign. I think I've only had like one person that didn't want to sign. So that's the communication we can work out in DMs.
So Fear Lantern, yeah, this is he's taking orders, like he's calling it, you can reserve an ash can.
Yeah, it's basically a reserving.
Email,
yeah.
Facebook, Twitter, whatever. He's looking to fulfill it by Christmas. And how many pages is it going to be?
Altogether, I'm not quite sure yet, because there's going to be a lot of as far as the art goes, it's the first six pages of the book, scripted and inked, so black and white. And there's going to be a lot of extras inside the book. Like I said, there's going to be character sketches, bios. I'm going to go into an in-depth history of the character itself without spoilers. So this isn't going to ruin issue one for anybody that backs it in the future. But it'll give you a leg up on anybody else that hasn't got the ash can as to what's going on in the world, the direction the story is and all that. So there's going to be some fun stuff in there. And there's some things I don't want to say either. I'm trying to keep a surprise for the people that get it. They're going to be in there.
And the other question, which he's already answered, is yes, this is your pencils. This is Jimmy Reyes's inks. But you've got Joe Weems inking the actual interiors.
Yeah, so on the interior.
Is that what this is here?
Yeah. So that's Joe Weems right there. That's page 5. Yeah, it's page 5 of the ash can. So yeah, that's Joe Weems over my work. And I haven't posted the Matt Bat Banning page that's going to be in there, and I'm not going to. Yeah, that's going to be exclusive to the book, so that's never going to see social media at all. But the stuff I've been showing off, the things I've been showing off for a second now, so I figured it wasn't that big of a deal. No script here. Obviously there will be script when you read it. But yeah, so this is Joe Weems, man. This is the legendary, in my opinion, legendary inker Joe Weems. You know, like this guy put up in my top 5 for sure. Right up there with Bat, you know.
Sure. I mean, looking at these, I think this is the third page I've seen now of yours. These are some of the best black and whites I've seen in Comicsgate ever. There's a lot of energy. I love this style. I love this sort of stuff. It's all the stuff that I don't do. I wouldn't dare do any of this stuff. This is real pro level art you're doing here. And judging by now, who's the colorist? Are you gonna get the same colorist on when you do the, I don't know if the ash can is colored or not. So
the ash can will be black and white. The actual book, when it comes out, or when the book comes out, the campaign will be in April, but the actual book is being colored by the guy that did the cover, which is Brian Valenza. You can see him working on, he does a lot of stuff for Top Cow. He's doing stuff for Rob Liefeld right now with a lot of the Marvel covers. I think he's doing Battlebrick Road from what I heard the other day. So the dude's fantastic. Got an awesome palette.
This is just, this is really awesome. That palette is just, I mean, it's mouth-watering. It really, really is great. So this is going to just...
Oh, I can't wait to see what
this is super exciting. This could be one of my most anticipated books of next year. Well, you know, everyone's thinking about that at the moment with the with the awards and everything. This could be in my collection for next year. It's really cool looking stuff here. There's a couple of other questions I think I saw. We answered Alexi's. If you're not on social media, you can send an email. Hopefully you've got an email.
Joe
says
Sontag,
it's about male projection. Women don't really care about size. That's not what I've heard, John. I'm sorry.
I've heard mixed reviews on that one.
I've heard. Jasper Still says, I would say make it small, handmade and punk rock at Kinko's.
Oh,
or upsize. There you go. Yeah, print it at home.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm hoping everyone, Mo says, I'm hoping everyone in CG got their monocles because they'll need them to read the tiny ARO box. Mo's going like this size, you know.
Yeah, yeah, that's
printed
awesome.
On rice. Rob asks, so how do I buy this Spawn book?
slide up my DMs, Rob. I'll give you the newest Spawn book.
Talking about characters that are inspired by other characters.
You know, and
right, scrolling down. People are loving your art. They're loving the look of the book.
I appreciate it. Thank you guys.
Man, I'm really far behind in the chat, but you know, we're getting there. We're getting there. Fear Lantern asks, is there a sketch version cover or is that cover in black and white on the interior?
So I will probably post the black and white version within the book itself. Because that was another poll I put up. If people wanted the black and white cover or if they wanted the colored cover, because if they wanted the black and white cover, I was going to have the logo still be red and, you know, do something like emboss it or, you know, make it pop out or something. But the actual cover to this is going to be in color, and I think we're going to do it on a foil cover too, to really make it shiny and stand again, make it something special for the collectors out there and everyone that's backing the ash can. So I'm trying to put some extra bells and whistles on it as far as I can and what I can afford to do.
All right. So we've heard about what your plans are. We've talked about this, I guess it's a method, I suppose. You know, it kills a few birds with one stone. You get the copyrights all sorted. You get a sort of interesting way of kind of creating a collectible to sort of build buzz and gauge interest before the campaign, all that sort of stuff. It's fun to do. It really is fun to make stuff and actually produce it and get it out there. But on top of all that, we haven't talked about Reaper Destroyer. Is that the name of the main character, Reaper?
So I guess you could say that's the name of the main character. There's an entity in the book. It's the ancient spirit of death, or one of the ancient spirits of death. And in the book, in mythology, it's called the Reaper Destroyer. The actual name of the guy that we follow, our hero, is his name is Matt Walker. And he's the one that's actually trapped inside this suit along with the ancient spirit of death. And they're kind of in this continuous struggle for control. But neither of them can take control for some odd reason. While they're in the suit, and neither of them know why they're trapped in here
with me.
Yeah. So the entire relationship between them is like this uneasy kind of alliance that they have to do to figure out what happened to them, and also stand up against the impending evil, the true evil that is about to come onto the earth. That's a short snippet. Like I said, if you get the ash can, I'm going to go into greater
depth.
I think that's a great pitch.
I like the idea they're not only fighting exterior battles, but they're also fighting, you know, amongst themselves, stuck in this suit.
Yeah, it was really important. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, for a book that looks like this, that's pretty much like what I'm expecting. A nice launching pad to jump off with. It's a great premise, a cool concept. That's it. We don't talk about concept enough.
Right.
And it's cool to just see a cool concept you can explain in a sentence there like that.
Yeah, it was really important to me to have a conflict between the main character, Matt, and the ancient spirit, and not just be like, hey, you know, we're two characters that got together. Now we're going to form an alliance. We're going to be badass and fight evil, you know? So I really wanted to have a conflict there so that there was an uneasiness within the book itself, because the whole aspect of what the Reaper Destroyer or whatever, I've got an actual name for that character, but I don't want to reveal it now because it's going to be something that's going to be in the book, but we'll just call it the Reaper Destroyer or the spirit for right now. His whole motivation is to possess a human being to carry out his goals, his mission. And so that's the whole thing. Like, he's trying to possess Matt. Matt is trying to keep from being possessed. and they're both trapped inside this biological suit of armor, if that's what you want to call it, and neither of them know why they're there, how they got there. I also wanted to touch a little bit on PTSD, because our main character, Matt, suffers from it, from the traumatic experience of becoming this thing, or what put them into this. So we're gonna see that throughout the story, how that affects him.
Is there a reason why you wanted to do a story on PTSD?
With Sean, you know, his character has diabetes because he has diabetes. With mine, mm-hmm. It just, when I was thinking of motivations and thinking of story, it was just something that popped in my mind of how would somebody react to what this main character went through. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll cover that in the story, but how would somebody react going through a traumatic event like that? And, you know, a lot of times there's the post-traumatic stress disorder that it, you know, goes along with that. So I was like, man, it's a really interesting concept to put into a character struggle, you know, instead of just having this guy be, you know, badass all the time. There's got to be something that he's dealing with, something that he's got to overcome, you know. And I was like, this, you know, besides the fight with the spirit for his soul, you know, this was another aspect of the mystery, you know, because I'm really trying to build also a mystery with this book as well that we're going to be going on.
Mo says, hearing about killing birds with stones reminds me of the pull out pigeon Daredevil Born Again style arc where he gets a kidney stone. I'm eagerly awaiting that that storyline, Mo. That sounds very intriguing.
I see Micro in the chat. So where did the suit come from, or is that a hidden plot point? Yeah, it's a hidden plot point for sure. That's sounds something like we got.
Now, is this you've got a number one there, so I presume it'll be kind of, you know, it's your ongoing thing. This will be your IP.
Yeah, so this is my IP. I'll be working on this for the foreseeable future. It's an ongoing story. The first story arc is 6 issues, but I could pull that down to 4 issues if I wanted to. And I'll say, like, when I first started developing this, I didn't know about crowdfunding and I didn't know about CG at the time. So my original thought was, you create a book, you try to get it picked up by a publisher, you know, and you go from there. So mm-hmm. It was originally put into a standard comic book format, 22 pages, boom.
That's so 2010, Joe.
Right, exactly. So once I got into ComicsGate and the crowdfunding thing, I had to retool a little bit and add pages in the book to make it a little bit more worthwhile. So it is only a 32 page book, but it's
but it comes with a punch.
It definitely comes with a punch. And I'm got some, like I said, I got the team I put together. It's got some top talent on this book. Like, it's gonna be well worth it visually, and I just hope that I can put the story together that's compelling enough for everybody as they're reading it.
Well, I mean, look, judging off the art alone, I think this is going to do very well. And you really sold a chat here. I'm reading all the comments. People love you, Joe.
Well, thank you.
People want you to become my new co-host. No, I'm like, no, they really like you. They want me to, what have you got there? Hold on a second.
I was going to say, I got some other stuff I can show you. So
holy cow.
This was actually the first page I got back from Joe Weems. That was blown away, you know, because this was one of my favorite pages, because this was a splash page, with, even though it's not a splash, but it's the closest I could get working with my writer, and I love my writer, and it's my story, my plot, but I brought a writer on so that I could make sure that the pacing was good, you know, and character development, all this stuff, all the stuff that I'm weak with, you know, like, I wanted to make sure that the weak parts of me that went and got really strong.
Joe, have you been listening to what the fans have been asking for? It sounds like you have.
I try.
It sounds like you have. So not only have you got a legendary inker working on this book, an incredible colorist, but you recognize that maybe, even though you've got a story inside you, you're not necessarily the number one vessel to get it on the page. So you've hired a real writer to help you with that.
Yeah,
I'm liking what I'm hearing here, and I'm loving what I'm seeing. Vanessa, though, she says people want you to do a big boy campaign.
it's coming. April.
There we go.
And again, like, the reason why the Ashcan is out right now, or available for reserve is, one, generate excitement. Two, I'm trying to coincide that with the release of it so people can start seeing it get out there. And then I'm going to drop the mailing list for the campaign in April. And then three, the backdoor way of doing a copyright, sending your IP through the mail, you know, and getting it stamped and all that kind of stuff without having to really go out and spend, drop lots of money on everything.
Well, look, I don't know what it's like in America, but I mean, if you get this ash can out, and someone was saying earlier, I'm sorry, I didn't pull it up, but they would love to get this as a Christmas gift. Mm. The goal is to get it out by Christmas. Yeah, it was see money.
Yeah.
Not looking for a hard deadline. This would make a killer Christmas gift for my brother. That's the goal, to get that's this out goal. By Christmas. Yep. I'm not making that promise, but that's what he's striving for.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do. And basically, it's a lot of it has to do with the printing schedule and when I can get it to print. I have to get the script finalized and edited, and then I got to get it out to get it lettered, and then I got to get it put together, and then the extra bells and whistles that I'm putting into the ash can to make it worth it and make it a collectible for everybody, and then send it to printing. So my goal is to still, at this point, looks pretty good to try to get it out by Christmas. Or at least in the hands by Christmas or around Christmas.
I don't see why you wouldn't be able to. It's gonna. These pages are gonna stay black and white. You're doing what? Six story pages.
Six story pages
plus the extra stuff. I think you should be able to do it. Lola says I should come to the U.S. What if I could? Maybe I can. I don't.
There
know.
You go.
We'll see. yeah, I'm definitely interested. Definitely interested. Jasper asks, what age level is this appropriate for this? I'm not talking about just the ash can, but the
the book itself.
Story.
I mean, it's violent, but it's
I read Spawn with the pedophile clown when I was 11, and I loved it.
I was just going to say,
enough of it.
Yeah, you're probably right around like that 12, 13 to whatever age. You know, I mean, there's mature content. But it's not like overly violent, you know, with gore. There's going to be gore. You know, it's comic stuff. You know, if you could make it through Spawn in the 90s, as far as age group goes, you Spawn the Darkness, you know, like that kind of level of brutality. But it's not centered on, like, I don't go in there just like I want to draw as much gore as I can, or I want to draw, you know, as much boobs as I can. Although I do enjoy drawing boobs.
You do enjoy to partake in a little bit of boobage,
as we all
do from time to time.
It's safe for a wide range, I would say, of readership.
Dying Days asks, has he finished spruiking TikTok yet? Don't tempt me. Don't tempt me. I always have a tab open, ready to go.
Oh, geez.
Shaggy Bear says it's official. Michael loves pedo clowns. Well, I love that book. I was reading, you know, there was still the Comics Code Authority at that point, wasn't there?
Oh,
Marvel books. Maybe they were. Yeah, I can't remember, but either way,
not an image. Yeah.
Not an image. No, but either way, you know, I was reading Spider-Man books, even though in the 80s, Spider-Man, after a hard day's web slinging, he got back to Mary Jane when she was a model. And he was getting down, but I couldn't believe what a crazy book Spawn was.
That's why I love Image so much.
Young mind.
Compared to
Marvel, I remember this page. Look at this.
Yeah. So this is the first page of the book. Just again, beautifully inked.
I love a good background. You know that. You know I love a good background.
I do. Well, I mean, compared to your backgrounds, man. Like I said, I think your
backgrounds
are phenomenal.
Come on, man. No. These are... People go on about it. Just because I'm obsessed with backgrounds, people go on about my backgrounds. These are absolutely right there.
Thank you.
Really killer stuff. I'm just studying. I love how you've got, you know, so as they go in the distance, they get less detail. They're sort of like scratching out a little bit, and then they're just outlines. That city skyline you've done there is superb.
Thank you.
It's one thing that I do notice in a lot of indie comics these days is a lack of backgrounds, and then also a lack of establishing shots and stuff like that that I think really need to be in there. And it doesn't need to be much. Like, look at that. That's just one horizontal panel, and you're set. You know,
for
the next however many pages. But this, I remember when you showed this page, That's when I really sat up and said, okay, all right. I see what, you know, Joe's a contender. Joe's a real contender here.
It's like you said, like it's really important. I mean, there's an art to comic book storytelling, you know, sequential storytelling, you know, like you said, you got the establishing shot. You should have some good variety of long range close-ups, different camera angles, anything that helps you move through the page easily, which is what I try to do, but keep it in a dynamic fashion. But I want you to be easily lead your eyes through the page. You know, like I really get into, and I'm still learning, you know, there's a lot I still need to learn about storytelling, but I really get into what storytelling is about and what it should be about, and not just putting a bunch of, you know, splashy art around. And don't get me wrong, there'll be a lot of big panels and stuff in the book, but I do enjoy some good storytelling.
It's funny when I guess it was just really helpful to me to have grown up with comic books, even though I hadn't been into them in a big way for many, many years. When I sat down to actually make my own, it was really surprising to me that a lot of the things that you kind of need to do sort of came naturally. And I put that up to the fact that I read them for so long. You just kind of absorb the way that they work. Like yeah. having, okay, you need a establishing shot here. Like things just felt like they were missing. I remember I was always, I tell this story quite a bit. There's a French bande dessinée that I was reading, and the backgrounds were really, that's why I bought it. I bought it because the backgrounds were really cool. And I wanted to sort of study, you know, sometimes you don't know, like how does this person draw a fountain with water going?
Oh, right.
That's real, right? You don't really know how to draw that. You can't reference a photo of a fountain and glean from that how you should be inking it. But anyway, I was reading, I was like, I'm really disconnected from this story. I'm not into it. There's nothing pulling me in. And I realized what it was. The artist was just using all reference photos, like standing at, you know, eye height, taking photos of things in either the middle distance or the background.
Right.
There was nothing up close. There was nothing to kind of pull the reader into the story. Like you've got here on this cityscape here. You could have just had the cityscape. You didn't have to have on the right there. You didn't have to have that silo. You didn't have to have this edge of a building on the left, but you actually did have to, because that's how you actually place the reader into the scene,
right?
With something that's up close, stuff like that. So
yeah, storytelling. You're right.
It's like you learn these things. I was really kind of surprised when I went back and looked at all my work, because I hadn't thought about this. This was all sort of intuitive. That I had added a lot of that stuff into the art. And I was like, I guess that's, just because of, you know, the years of absorbing comic books and how they're made.
Yeah, a lot of it. Yeah, if you read comics, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that you'll just naturally kind of grab onto because you read so much stuff over the years. That you kind of, you catch it without knowing that that's meant to be there. It's there for a reason, you know. But yeah, like you said, storytelling is great. I love the art of storytelling sequential pages.
Elliot Rodriguez agrees. It establishes the foreground. Great stuff. Mo points out, Bancroft's background studies really paid off. The next stop characters. I made sure, I don't know if you guys remember, about 6 months ago, Dan Frager was shopping around this guy. I cannot remember the name of the guy, unfortunately. He's a very, very famous cartoonist. He did a comic, you know, every day. He did a page every day for like 50 years or something.
Oh, wow.
And he's an absolute legend. And Dan Frager got a hand of digital scans of years of work. And the amazing thing about it is the faces, all the hands, the gestures, the expressions, and the clothing. So I made sure to get in touch with Dan, because I'm going to study the hell out of that stuff. Because, you know, it's important to understand and recognize where you're... weak spots are, and it wasn't Charles Schultz, no. Although I did grow up, I love Charles Schultz.
Here, I'll show you one more while we got some time, but like references, I enjoy references, but at the same time, I also like pulling from the imagination as much as possible. Because like you said, I don't
want to have... These are comics, after all.
Right, yeah. I wanted to keep the energy. One of the things about... We were talking about the backgrounds. Specifically, when you jump to this page, when it becomes more action, like panel one, I phased out the building. So when it's colored, I've got a color scheme in mind. I'm going to let Brian just kind of do his thing. But you're talking about action here where you've got a really bright blast, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's really not a lot of... reason for me to go in and put a lot of detail in those buildings. One, it would muddy up the picture a lot if there's like all these details of the building.
It slows the action down.
Exactly. Yeah. Yep. So at this point it's like, all right, pull back, show, you know, we know where we're established at. So let's pull back and let's really focus on the action in a page like this. So it's fun stuff, you know, like just things I picked up or listened to artists talk mm-hmm. about, you know, why they do certain things in pages and you know when to put a lot of detail here, when to pull back detail here, because you also have a colorist you work on a book. Yeah, this is gonna be a black and white ash can, but the actual book is gonna be colored, and you got to give them room to play around and bring it all together, you know. Because I mean, Michael, you know exactly what colors can do for a book, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Makes it just, you know, that finishing beautiful touch,
kind
you know?
Of it kind of you know, it's like if the pencils and the inks and everything and the layouts are the sort of the body, the colors bring it to life. The you know, yeah. you, like Frankenstein over the monster is like, it's alive, you know, finally it's a living real thing, because it adds so much depth and atmosphere and life essentially to it. Eric says, I could get more creative with the panel layouts. I see this stuff all the time too, Eric, and that's what I say. Like when I see really cool stuff like this, I remember I had the same feeling with Charlie Snogan's, and I tweeted out and I said, Charlie Snogan's art makes me question my life choices. And it's exactly that. You're like, man, should I have gone down more this road and, you know, spent more time developing something a bit more fluid like this? And, you know, at the end of the day, you just got to go with what's right for you. I'm actually really happy with the, more European traditional direction that I've gone, because I don't think everyone should have the same thing. But do I love these crazy pages, you know, with these panels like this. It's really cool.
And you know, the fun thing about doing a book like this or whatnot is, in a normal kind of scene, I could do more traditional paneling, you know, but when you're amping up action or you're trying to show something that's intense or claustrophobic or whatever, it really allows you to be able to play around. I think making the panel is a part of the actual art of the page and not just the art within the panels themselves. And that's mm-hmm. one thing I really enjoy about doing, you know. So when I sat down to do a page like this or any of the other pages where I really have the freedom now just to do whatever, that's half the fun to me, is like, how do I lay the page out? Because it's going to be, I'm going to make that within itself an artistic aspect to the story besides the work within the panels. It's just, it's fun, man. Super
and I'm
fun.
Guessing all of this is going to be for sale pages eventually.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I've been asked that like on the campaign and I haven't made a decision yet. I know it would mean more money on the campaign if you were able to sell pages. But in the same the same breath, there's a part of me that doesn't want to part with any
part
of the
with
pages
them. I hear you.
When I get them back, you know. So like I don't know yet.
That's what Kennedy does. He doesn't sell his stuff. He just
There's a few artists I know that don't, and I'm, you know, I right now I'm leaning towards that, but I don't know, because when I actually get these back in my hands, it's gonna be hard to give them up. I'll say that.
The guy earlier I was talking about is a guy named Frank Godwin.
Mm.
Just a real, like, one of those people, like, we take so much of comic books for granted, just the language of comics. And there were, but we don't remember, like, there were guys who actually developed this, real people, real men who developed the language that we're all speaking now. And, you know, the reason we can push the barriers and get fringy with it and everything, is because these guys sort of wrote the language. You go back to the very, very early days. Not everyone drew comics in the same way that people draw them now. There's some weird stuff going on in there that didn't pass this, that didn't last the test of time.
Yeah.
But I've got hundreds of images from this guy called Frank Godwin that Dan Frager sent me that I'm just going to absolutely kind of print out and study and really improve my character drawing. That's my sort of, that's my thing for the third book. Cause I've got the vast majority of the second book already drawn.
Oh, nice.
It's for moving on and forward. I did want to, we've got 5 minutes left. So before we run, I did want to let everyone know that you have a YouTube, you have a couple of YouTube channels. So the first one is Joe M. Sontag. What goes on this channel?
This is my personal channel. I've really built this around a series I call Appreciating Comic Book Art. And a lot of that is I basically look at a lot of the books that inspired me over the years or had an impact on my life or things I just want to share. And I go through and we look at an entire book or something. I try to pull up old books as much as I can. I have a version of it that's also Appreciating Comic Book Art Live, where I'll have certain guests on, like I've had Malin on a couple times and Shelby Robertson and Art T-Bear, and we'll look at certain series of books. We looked at the entire Pit Run. We did some Jim Lee and McFarlane stuff, and that's really cool because I get a chance to talk to them and get their take on the art and the books, and you know, sometimes hear insider stories. So it's a very fun show when we do that live. This is also a channel. The more the campaign comes out and everything, there'll be more updates on here. There might be drawing videos that I will post and more actual talk about the book itself in the future. So I plan on doing a lot more than there is right now. But as of right now, it's just, if you like comics, if you like comic book art, it's a fun channel to check out. And give me feedback. Let me know what you'd like to see on it.
So it looks like it's a mix of streams and uploaded vids, which is cool. And Micra said the X-Men video with art was awesome.
Thank you. That was super fun. I love art. Yeah, that was a great time.
Timothy Fitzgerald says that character looks like Azrael. I loved Azrael back in the Nightfall days.
Yeah. Yeah, so did I. So did I. The character... design of the character is a mashup probably of about, I would say, 10 different characters, if I broke it down.
This is the Art and Stuff show, which is the show that you do with Sean.
Yep.
This is sort of more your more in line with a kind of a Comic Skate channel. You hang out, you get creators on, you talk about things. You had Phil Diaz on talking about Lost Pages. You got Dojo Kun in there with the Shifter. Passion for drawing, that sort of stuff. Popular channel, starting to become a popular channel in these parts. And you're of course on the both of these channels are on the Road to 1000 race.
Yes,
you should be. You'd be right up there on your other one now.
I'm getting close. I'm in the early 800s.
You know, second or third place or something with 812.
Yeah, I think it was up there for a little bit. I think. Somebody's already reached 1,000, I think. I can't remember. It's been a second since I actually looked, but I thought it was a fun concept when I saw it posted. I was like, all right, I'll start pushing it. I mean, I'd love to get to 1,000 subscribers. That would be awesome.
Filthiest chat in CG is Jasper's accusation. Is that of art and stuff? Is it really filthy?
Yeah, it used to be. It hasn't been as of late, but there was a point in time where that was our calling card. You know, you have the sexiest chat in CG. Ours was like the dirtiest chat in CG. Yeah, it was a lot of dirty jokes.
Everyone's got to have their thing. Well, that's really cool, man. I'm going to just very quickly go back to Reaper Destroyer Ashcan. He's trying to get this thing out by Christmas. It's $20 free shipping in the US. If you really need it and you're international, I guess send him an email. See if you can figure something out. Is there a cutoff point? Like, when do people need to get in touch with you?
Yeah, so through November 19th. So we're going to be doing a closeout stream on Art and Stuff on Friday, November 19th, and that'll be the last time I'm taking orders. So that would be the final number and what I'm going to print with.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
I will overprint, so but it'll be more expensive to get after because whoever got it first, you know, I don't want to disrespect them. That's right. I got to be true to those guys and gals.
We're seeing a lot of new names in here. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Drawn Sword Graphics is killer style. Thank you. And if anyone is new here, please make sure you subscribe and like and all that sort of stuff. We do this show 4 nights a week. Late night with Comics Gate, lots of different shows. Yesterday we did horse racing. Tonight we're doing a kind of a little deep dive on Reaper Destroy Ashcan and chatting about this. I guess it's this method of putting small books out before campaigns to wet the whistle of the people, gauge interest, and secure copyrights and have fun because making stuff is fun. So please send Joe, it's joemsontag@gmail.com, an email, or hit him up at joemsontag1 on Twitter. You're also on Facebook and Instagram.
Yep. If you search my name, you'll be able to find him. But yeah, I've taken orders from all four of those options so far. So you should be able to get me if you would like a copy.
SDA wants me to wet his whistle. No, that will not be happening. And also, if you like the cut of Joe's jib, please make sure you go and subscribe to him on his channels and check out what he's up to. C-Money asks, Bancroft betting on the Melbourne Cup? We did. I put $50 on and then I left to go do the show. Mel put another $15 on because that wasn't enough for her. She needed to bet more. And we won nothing. We won exactly zero. We lost all our money. But Hockey in the chat, he was a smarter man. He put just $5 on and he won $75.
Oh, there you go.
So he did much better than we did. But we had six winners yesterday. Ryan Blue Thunder won a copy of, because we do a sweepstakes. I don't know if you caught it, Joe. We did sweepstakes. Everyone puts their name in and whatever horses win, they win. And I had a selection of books. And, you know, whoever won got to pick first. So Ryan Blue Thunder won. He picked Jawbreaker's Lost Souls. So he's got that. We sent that out today. I got Simply Green came second. They won a copy of The Lucent Waking Dream. And then our own Aerith Saga from, we all know Brian, Aerith Saga, the Kuma, the Coom King. Dwarves and Lions and Air Saga and everything. He picked up my Crackhead cut. Unedited edition. And then a bunch of others, they won because there were so many people entering. I think we got about, ended up with about 50 people entering. I couldn't send away all that stuff. They got like a little Lucent sticker and magnet postcard pack. It's fun. We do fun things over here. That's what we got to do. Reading comics is fun. Collecting comics is fun. So you send out books, but not wrenches. Rob, stop shaming me. Rob, do you want me coloring Replicator or do you want me working with manufacturers in Moorabbin to get novelty wrenches laser engraved? I don't even know the situation now with things are being open and everything. But Jasper says Last Place should have gotten the War Campaign book.
Oh, jeez.
I have two copies of that book. So I thought I'd just offer it up. Someone might want it. We don't pass judgment over here. Mo says, Rob, the wrenches are only a year or so. I should make Mel do it. Yeah, I should. That'd actually get done. All right, our hour is up. Thank you so much, Joe, for coming and hanging out with us tonight. We were minus one Joe tonight, but the Joe we got, I think he's worth double. He made up for it.
Oh, thank you.
Really excited to see what you're going to be coming out with. I mean, going forward, this is really cool stuff. This could be. I have very high hopes for this IP.
I really appreciate it, man. Thank you. And I appreciate all the support. Everyone has been great so far to both me and Sean, and it's been fantastic. I love the chat, love CG. It's the only way that creators like me would have a chance to put a IP out there and fulfill a dream of making a comic book.
Jasper says he's going to poach me as a colorist. I've got to color a book called Painted Death properly. It's a pretty big deal for me. It's the follow-up to my first campaign, so maybe not, but we'll see how we go in the future. Until then, thank you, Joe. The biggest thank you of all goes out to the wonderful, amazing, sexiest chat in all of CG. Thank you, everyone, for hanging out with us tonight, and we will see you again tomorrow night with another one. Until then, have a great night. Bye.